Hello and welcome to this little research and practice brief series. The purpose of this series is to have conversations around the innovative use of technology in special education, early childhood, related services, and leadership personnel preparation programs. Today, we have Dr. Matt Marino as our guest expert to share his research and practice on game-based learning for STEM education. Dr. Marino is a professor of exceptional education at the University of Central Florida and the director of the Toni Jennings Exceptional Education Institute. His award-winning research on game-based learning, STEM education, executive function, universal design, and artificial intelligence has positively impacted thousands of students and their teachers across the United States. Welcome, Dr. Marino.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks for joining us. Let's deep dive into game-based learning and STEM education. So what issues are you trying to address through your work?
Yeah, it's interesting. So when I started out, I had a bachelor's degree in animal science. And really, once I started teaching, my goal very quickly became to ensure that all students, including those with disabilities, have the opportunity to participate in meaningful STEM careers if they're interested, right? So when I think back to what my early career looked like and the kids who were struggling so much, it was because, first of all, I didn't really know what I was doing as a new teacher. And second of all, the content was really unobtainable for them. So if you think about vocabulary that we're introducing for kids in secondary school, secondary being sixth grade through 12th grade, they have more new vocabulary words in a science class than they do in a foreign language class. And words like endoplasmic reticulum or deoxyribonucleic acid were absolutely impossible for my students with learning disabilities to read. So I started looking for alternative ways to present the information and assess students' understanding of it.
I really liked how your motivation came from your experience and that all students who are interested in STEM career should be able to achieve their goal and to pursue it. So can you walk us through how game-based learning can support STEM learning for all students, including those with disabilities?
I've always been someone who really enjoyed games, right? I think learning needs to be fun. And games promote learning by presenting students with authentic problems or challenges that they wouldn't otherwise be able to solve. So, for example, one of the first games I examined was called Alien Rescue. And this was a game that's a virtual puzzle game. It challenged students to find homes for alien species in our solar system. And in the beginning of the game, the students watched this professional, or back in the day, it was a professionally done video showing these aliens coming into our solar system. And then they're challenged in their classrooms to find planets in our solar system or moons that would be beneficial to the alien species. And so if they don't find a habitat for the students, or I'm sorry, for the aliens, then the aliens die, right? And they don't want that to happen. And so we studied the impact that this game had on 1,400 kids from 16 different teachers in four different middle schools. So it's a pretty big sample for someone working on their doctoral degree. And what we found is the factors influencing their learning was the first one that was most important was really engagement. And so the kids were excited to be learning more about the content than they were when they just had a textbook in front of them, right? The other thing that we found that was very beneficial for them was that the students would engage in spontaneous conversations about their gameplay. And so this was something that we didn't see when the teacher said to them, go read these three pages and then we're going to talk about it. The students were very very attuned to what they were doing individually, and maybe the teacher had them filling out a worksheet, which I hated. But then in this game-based environment, the kids are talking to each other as they're experiencing and learning the information. And so that was one of the most powerful things that we found through this game-based research. Now, I've had maybe 10 funded game production projects at this point in my career from a number of different agencies, National Science Foundation, IES, and through these different replications of these experiments, we've seen the same thing over and over again. I think that the biggest benefits come in science, but we're also seeing them in computer science and mathematics as well.
I've been really thinking that the first step of learning is to be engaged and interact with other people to learn the hard or difficult concept more in a more interesting way. And I really appreciate how you turn all the STEM related learning, more making it more game based and make it more fun. So.
And so, it's I had to tell a little story here because the first grant that I ever received to study game-based learning was with a company called Filament Games out of Madison, Wisconsin. And shout out to them because they were fabulous. We're working together. Neither one of us really knew that much about what we were doing. We understood the research and development process, but we didn't know what it took to implement a game at large scale. We ended up winning a STEM award from the US Department of Education because we built this game that was called You Make Me Sick. And now that we've gone through COVID, we probably don't want to bring that up very much because you would think like that it would look, people would look down on that now. But the idea was we can take the kids and give them the ability to custom design a bacteria or virus. And the goal in the game is to infect people and get them as sick as possible. And I got to tell you, the kids loved it, and so did the teachers. Again, now you might see a different response because we've been through COVID and everyone knows all the negatives that came along with that. But back in the day when we were doing that, it was something that you could never do with kids if it wasn't in a virtual environment. And so the game-based learning really got the kids excited about learning about the principles of different bacteria and viruses.
I'd also like to try that if there's any chance. How
Yes.
did you integrate these game-based learning for STEM into your teacher preparation program?
Yeah, so, I will give the example from the last build that we did. So I was working on a project called Model Mathematics Education. And this was a video game that we were co-developing with a team out of North Carolina State University. Dr. Jessica Hunt there is an expert in dyscalculia and fraction awareness for kids in grades 4 through 6. And so she had an idea to take a curriculum she developed during her PhD early career award at NSF and take that and turn it into game-based learning. So we started building this with funding from the National Science Foundation. And as we were going along, we brought in our pre-service teachers and shared iterations of the game with them. We used what's called the lean startup models developed by Eric Ries back in 2011. And it's the lean startup model is a way to iteratively design products where you're building it, measuring its outcome, and then learning from it so that it's continuously getting better. We integrated that in our pre-service teacher education program at multiple universities, so that our pre-service teachers were learning about this iterative cycle and then able to see how we were implementing it and help us design the implementation methods we would be using in the classroom.
How can we better prepare educators for using these technologies in the field?
That is a really tough question. I think that technology is evolving so rapidly right now. I'm not sure we can do that. And what I mean by that is that the technology today has a shelf life that's much shorter than what it was when I was in the classroom. right? Another challenge is licensing agreement. And so if you have a licensing agreement in one school and you move to a different school in that district, you may have a different licensing agreement. And so as I'm preparing pre-service teachers, I don't know what technology is going to be available to them because it's based on the school and district that they go to. So I think a better approach is to teach them how to critically use or analyze and use a product that's technology based so that when they get out into a classroom environment, they can look and say, this product has these accessibility features and allows students to use these cognitive processes or exhibit this level of cognitive load. And it also has benefits through different types of assessment items, for example. So I think the evaluation of the technology is more important than cool tools, right? Because a cool tool today in 6 months might not be a cool tool any longer. Does that make
So since
sense?
since technology is evolving so rapidly and there are new tools every time, we as teacher educators can support them to make informed decision every time the new ones comes up, or like ones with better instructional design integrated.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So what implications do you see for future research, and what are some questions we might be asking?
Yeah, so implications is interesting. I had a doctoral student who I want to shout out to now, Dr. Kenneth Holman, and he's gone on and is now a professor up in Georgia, an assistant professor up in Georgia. But he was interested in using AI chatbots to promote conceptual understanding of fractions. And he was one who partnered with me on that project I was talking about earlier, the model mathematics education. I think that the AI-based technologies are really the wave of the future. We should be asking about what features of the chatbot lead to the largest gains in student learning. So he had a chatbot that learned about the student it was helping, and then it would use what it learned about the kid to present problems to them in a unique way. For example, if you had a 10-year-old who was interested in sports statistics, and it was this kid was learning about mathematics in an elementary classroom, the chatbot might say to them, "Hey, let's look at batting averages from five different professional athletes and talk about how those batting averages can relate as fractions to their overall batting score." Does that make sense?
So do you mean that the AI, the function of AI can personalize
Yes,
the
that's what I'm saying. So the AI
content?
in his case is personalizing it for each kid so that they have a personalized tutor. I think that's a wave of the future that we should be integrating into our games. We can actually do that right now if we go in and use some of these commercial AI programs, they will actually provide you with the script you need to create that. And it can happen in moments, right? So let's say I spend 10 minutes designing a game, it will actually give me a script to build and run the game in seconds. I think that's amazing.
AI sounds like a very potential model, tools or models that can support individual students to adapt to the interests and skills and level abilities and levels. So
Absolutely.
what else should teacher preparation programs consider moving forward?
You know, one of the things I really think we need to consider is the fact that our gold standard in education research is published peer-reviewed journal articles, right? The problem with that is that the review and publication cycle for each of these is much slower than the pace at which technology is evolving. So if we take and as researchers at the university, if we do a study for, say, the National Science Foundation, and it takes 3 years to finish that study, and then we build something and we go out and study it, write a paper about it, send it out for peer review, we get questions back, we make modifications, then it has to go through the publication cycle. Now we're looking at 4 years since we actually began that project. That period of time is too long. So I think one of the things that we have to do is create a community where members can come together with researchers to discuss ideas about practical applications in their classrooms. Do you know where that's
Right.
happening?
Yeah.
Do you know where that's happening, Yaren? Right at the Siddle Center. And I
.org.
think that's fabulous.
So, are there any resources and tools you can suggest for those who would like to learn more about game-based learning or STEM education?
Yeah, I just want to kind of summarize a recent review of literature that I saw, and it was looking at the effect sizes associated with game-based learning and STEM. And the findings from that were that digital education games significantly enhance STEM learning outcomes compared to traditional education, meaning a book-based system, especially for cognitive skills, with strategy games yielding the strongest effect sizes, a G of 0.624. Also, game design matters, right? So how you're designing your games is really important. I would say in terms of resources, there's a number of game design books out there, but in the interest of UDL, you don't need to necessarily go to one of these game design books. There's also many videos that you can watch and podcasts you can follow. So I would say do your own research, find the mechanism that you learn best from, and do a deep dive on your own. The final finding from this that I want to bring up is that the subject area and assessment type moderate effectiveness. And so digital game-based learning showed higher gains in science and computer science than in mathematics or engineering. And so I think understanding that there's going to be differences is important, but at the same time, understanding that those differences are based on a number of factors that we may or may not have control over.
Thank you, Dr. Marino, for sharing your research on game-based learning for STEM education. I appreciate your time and work and look forward to learning more about your work.
Thank you so much. I
For more,
appreciate you taking the time to speak with me.
yeah, thank you so much. And for more information about CIDL research and practice briefs and other resources for teacher and related services personnel preparation, please go to CIDL.org. Don't forget to follow us on social media, subscribe to our channel, and leave us a message. Thank you all for joining us.